people everywhere. I am GM Grenna, King's Tither 1238, here in King's House 33329, Redondo Beach, California. And today, I'm juxtaposing two Bible teachers I greatly admire, Dr. Gene Scott and Evangelist Jonathan Shuttlesworth. I'm fairly confident that most of the people viewing this video are going to be familiar with one of these men, but not the other. So I'm going to share clips of each for educational purposes, criticism in the spirit of Proverbs 27:17, and personal commentary about their special ability to reach an audience of uncommon people attracted to God. I'm also going to challenge you with this overall context. If a friend or family member gave you a gun with no bullets, would you want to go into a violent neighborhood with it? Think about that for a few minutes while I do some channel housekeeping. As I've done for each of my Gene Scott-related videos, I'm going to provide a courtesy statement for his widow's staff and their legal team responsible for protecting the copyrighted material she owns. The rare audio clips I'm sharing here were published and are owned by the Assemblies of God organization. Doc relinquished his rights for their benefit, so his widow cannot make a legal claim upon them from me. Likewise, for most of the video clips I'm going to share here, Doc granted them to ABC News in 1983 for a special segment produced by Edward J. Asiano to explain the legal battle he had that year with the FCC. So again, his widow cannot make a legal claim upon them from me. And please note that the tvbn.org watermark on those clips is unrelated to their original broadcast. The only reason I'm not covering it up is to dissuade viewers from asking me about it. The final clips of Doc I'm going to interleave with Jonathan, which do not have the tvbn.org watermark, are indeed the intellectual property of Melissa Scott. However, as with other videos I've posted here on YouTube, my presentation of them is covered by fair use law, because I'm using them for criticism, comment, and teaching. And they meet three factors a court would use in a fair use case. Number one, the purpose and character of the use is not a commercial nature. It's for nonprofit educational purposes, where I contrast Doc's shows with those of his widow and Jonathan. Number two, the amount and substantiality of the portion I'm using in relation to the copyrighted work as a whole is trivial. I'm showing less than a minute of the original show, which spanned more than an hour. And number three, the effect of my use upon the potential market for or value of the copyrighted work actually benefits Mrs. Scott because it increases demand for content she controls. In fact, I'm going to pause here for a few seconds to promote the recent update to DoloresPress.com, the website Mrs. Scott's church owns and operates, to sell her late husband's educational media as a tax-paying entity. The primary reason I'm making this video is to answer some important questions that Jonathan recently posed. He asked them rhetorically, not wanting anyone to answer them, but they do need to be answered per Isaiah 1:18 and 1 Peter 3:15. The secondary reason is to share two rare audio clips of Doc from an important lecture he delivered in August 1968 at the biennial meeting, the General Council of his Assemblies of God denomination. He referred to it proudly on multiple occasions in later years because of its prominence among fellow Pentecostals. A full transcript was published by the Assemblies in, let me get my book here. In this book, Our Mission in Today's World. And let me just see if I can thumb through to the page here. Page 25, is it? Yes, it is. The Message of the Church by Gene Scott. But an abridged version of this is available in a PDF online of the November 17, 1968 issue of the Pentecostal Evangel. It's provided by Flower Pentecostal Heritage Center, ifphc.org. I'll provide a link in the YouTube description under this video, but back in December 2012, I added it to Doc's Wikipedia entry, and it's still there for your convenience as of today. The clips I'm sharing here contain content that was not preserved in either publication. After Doc broke from the assemblies and began pastoring in Southern California, he often said he didn't pray on TV or in his weekly worship services at Faith Center, citing Matthew 6:6. In fact, he was sharply critical of pastors who prayed in church. So here's the first clip where he leads about 7,000 attendees in prayer.
Please, will you stand and let's pray together. Father, we don't think a preacher can, just because he steps to the podium, count upon that elusive something that we've learned to identify as the anointing of the Spirit. And there have been occasions that we have known audiences anointed to listen. We pray tonight that your Spirit will do that which only your Spirit can do. Quicken tired bodies, calm the anxious spirit, help us to do what we can do, which is commit our thoughts to you and honor that act as we take it together by speaking to us by your Spirit, both preacher and audience, that we might receive it from thee. Grant this, we pray. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen. And you may be seated.
Another way in which Doc broke from Pentecostal traditions was in his refusal to hold salvation altar calls. He often explained that if someone had an altar call experience where they placed their life figuratively on an altar for God, it should happen spontaneously while he preached, rather than by coercion afterward. Here's a clip from the end of that message when he invited men under the age of 40 to step forward and got ticked off when some decided to exit the auditorium.
I'm going to ask you to do something. We haven't asked for anybody to come up here yet in this meeting, but I'm going to ask you tonight. How many preachers in this audience are under 40 years of age? Men, will you stand? Do you believe what we're preaching tonight? The message is still Christ. You don't need to learn any new scientific or sophisticated, and please honor the altar call. It'll only be a moment. Don't anyone leave. 5 minutes won't kill you. I could name some on the platform that have been in the flesh what Paul was to me in memory in Rome. I listened to Brother Vogler as he prayed last night. And I said, God, challenge us to be like Paul. Not look on the things which are seen, but understand we have our hand in eternity, and we reach down to tell them of a Christ that lives and that can save them and that they can experience. I don't think this has to be long or complicated, but I've learned there need to be moments of truth in every life to where you can point to that spot and say, I took this step, like Paul did at Damascus. Now, I think I could talk some into coming if I stood here long enough, but I don't want that.
Doc had just celebrated his 39th birthday a couple weeks earlier, and Jonathan Shuttlesworth happens to be 39 this year. I discovered him a few months ago around the same time I discovered Charles Hamilton, pastor of King James Bible Baptist Church. Some of you may have seen the video I posted a few months ago showing how the same Holy Spirit who guided Doc obviously empowered Hamilton when his local government in Mississippi infringed upon his free exercise of religion. Pastors worldwide had the opportunity of a lifetime, especially Pentecostals, whose services involve physical meetings and physical contact, when governments issued orders excluding worship gatherings from lists of essential services, believing that weekly congregations would significantly increase deaths due to COVID-19, nearly all of them, including Doc's widow Melissa, complied, claiming to be erring on the side of caution. Actually, most of the ministries to whom I distribute God's tithe failed in like manner, figuratively bowing their knees to a fake deity. So even though I may seem to be harsh on Mrs. Scott, I still support her for the same reasons I support the other ministries whose leaders did not practice what they preach. Those of you familiar with Doc's teaching know that courage is the main ingredient of faith, without which it's impossible to please God. This is also relevant to my upcoming correction for Jonathan. Steadfast Christians can be completely wrong about and fail to practice one doctrine they teach, but still be completely correct about everything else. The example Doc often used was in 2 Corinthians 11, when Paul actually boasted about refusing to do the Lord's will. Likewise, Peter led the apostles steadfastly in Acts 2, the post-resurrection Pentecost, but was completely wrong when Paul blamed him for hypocrisy in Galatians 2. In sharp contrast with the majority of evangelists, Jonathan Shuttlesworth not only did not comply with the recent infringement of our rights, he actively promoted his preaching. Here's a clip of him at a Texas church on April 9th, which was holding outdoor services. Even a torrential rainstorm didn't slow him down. He just grabbed an umbrella and kept on preaching.
I don't care how many people told you you're stupid. You're not stupid. You're created in the image of God. You have a brilliant mind. You have an anointed mind. You're not somebody that God made as a mistake. You might have made mistakes, but tonight you can make up your mind. I'm not going to focus on things that are behind me. I'm going to focus on that which is to come. And God will bring you to your glorious future, and you'll be a testimony for Him. Amen. Thanks for the hums.
We'll not be opening the sanctuary this Sunday. You'll have to check every Friday. And I'm sorry to do this, but I'm doing this to err. I would rather err on the side of caution and protect you than to act in faith, which could actually be foolishness in saying whatever.
There's people that go to church and read the Bible, but they still consider themselves weak and defeated. The Bible does not have a picture of you weak and defeated. You were weak and defeated in sin. But when you joined up with the lion of the tribe of Judah, the brother of a lion is a lion. There is power on the inside of you to win every battle of life.
I would prefer to say somebody erred on the side of caution, and many lives were spared because of that caution, versus just being reckless and saying, well, let's see what happens.
You ever met Christians you wish you could shove a pipe in their mouth? Anything to shut them up.
That was East Texas. We saw people pulling off the road that heard us preaching and give their life to Jesus Christ, even though we're in a monsoon. The gospel will never stop, nor will the promises of God stop for those that stand to see the gospel of Jesus Christ preached to their generation.
The guy's energy level is off the charts. The name of his ministry is Revival Today, and a typical broadcast day consists of his associate, Evangelist Kofi, for about an hour in the morning, his wife, Adalis, and her twin sister, Megalis, for about an hour around noon. Then Jonathan teaches for about an hour in the late afternoon. All of it is solid, hardcore Pentecostal evangelism, as relevant as ever in today's sinful culture. This year he began a late night show called Check the News, where he shares social media posts of current events with his own Christian commentary. It's remarkably similar to Dr. Scott's off-the-cuff style of live TV broadcasts in the late 70s, early 80s. During the past few months, arguably the most entertaining episode featured him drinking a mixture of Red Bull soda and vanilla ice cream, which he blamed for his moody behavior. The original May 13th show was removed from YouTube, probably because it contained clips of medical doctors Dan Erickson and Artin Masihi countering the mainstream COVID-19 fear-mongering. But his staff made this four-minute montage of it, highlighting the funniest moments, which brought back fond memories of my Monster x-presso days that fueled some of my skyscraper staircase races, with controversial nitrogenated water.
Well, I simultaneously got the worst news and the best news I've ever gotten. I don't say ever gotten. But you talk about going on a roller coaster of emotions. And it doesn't help when you're drinking a little drink they make in the production room called a Red Bull mixed with ice cream. So my blood sugar is probably at 800-900 right now. Feeling pretty good. Let's check the news.
I don't like bureaucrats.
What better thing could we talk about than bird nest soup?
The man's a damn weirdo.
So I got news we're locked down in red till June 4th, and then like less than an hour later that our county's gonna move to yellow. Mix that in with a Red Bull ice cream drink with my blood sugar at around like the 1,000 mark. I have experienced, is this what pregnancy feels like? I went from a dark depression to the happiest I've been since my mom bought me a cotton candy at the state fair when I was 6. Can some women let me know if this is what pregnancy feels like? Because I'd like to know. Also, will I experience a crash before the end of the broadcast?
Listen to me. Hey, I haven't got much time. Hold it. Isn't this the way a bureaucrat acts? You hit them on the head, their eyes descend. You criticize them. Now watch him. Look at him. Look at the side view. Look at him. There he goes.
Man, I got my blood sugar so high right now, I'm dual formulating thoughts. What was I talking about? Oh, yeah. Believe all women. The laws of reality. Sorry, I was having trouble reading the words. My vision's starting to blur from the high blood sugar. I don't want to say there's a lot of sugar in this drink, but my one foot just turned black. But it is delicious.
That's the FCC for you. They just keep going around the circle and showing their, you know what.
Is it just me or has my IQ dropped significantly since the start of this broadcast? Next.
It's you.
I know. I don't know why I'm happy, like this happy, but it has to be this sugary drink. Next.
A world simply can't believe that a government agency, because I've called them monkeys, imbeciles, and the missing link, will use the instrument of power to humble me.
Friends, things are lifting. Nothing lifting higher than my blood sugar. But I'm in a super good mood.
I don't fit no mold. So, and I'm glad he doesn't fit a mold. He is who he is, and so am I.
My teeth hurt. Next. Let me just, you know, this probably isn't the best medical advice, but if you're having problems, like with how you feel about the lockdown, try drinking a mason jar full of Red Bull and ice cream and see how you feel when you're done with that.
Very vibrant, very alive, very undull. I think I said if I had to live with his brain for one day, I think I'd explode.
All kidding aside, I feel super good.
Watching him on a cable TV with my friends, be sitting around getting loaded basically, and we'd all go, this is real funny.
By the way, it's probably good I never drink alcohol since I can't even really handle my sugar. Next video.
First, I had a lot of reserve about Dr. Scott's fire and brimstone, but the thing that I think that really impresses me now more than ever is just his honesty. Well, he.
Less dangerous than COVID. You know, I'm not in the mood for this.
No,
next. Man, I find myself funny when my blood sugar's in the four digits. Keep going.
Brings the scriptures out more. I've been in the church my whole life, and he brings out things that I have never heard, you know, even after being in the church my whole life.
I finished my ice cream Red Bull, and then Nick, that runs our floor, asked if I'd like a second one, and I said, sure, and got, you know, like, I was already happy, I got even happier. And then he informed me there's none left, and now I feel violently angry.
I didn't start out pounding on monkeys. They call me and a church of 10,000 people crooks.
I want the whole world to understand, you ain't listening to a grinning imbecile that comes at you and will say anything and do anything and smile anything to get your money. And I'm the only man on television and radio in this whole wide world that says, don't you send me any money until I first teach you. When I got a that's unteachable, you obviously have never been taught by me. So nobody wants your money, and we sure don't want your g- opinion.
Is this what a substance abuse problem feels like? I have like a seething rage in my belly. No, you don't have to go get more ice cream. I'm just not like you anymore. Next.
Turn your knobs. You say you're swearing. No, I'm not. I know what God will damn, and I'm well in the stream of His will. That I ain't out here looking for friends. I'm out here to deliver the truth to people that don't get it anywhere else. You ain't paying for this television. You ain't paying for this radio. And you sure ain't paying me. And I ain't about to take your damn unsolicited advice.
Moral authority.
Back to me?
Not only from... Is this great or what? Not these shorts that in no way go with this suit, but what he's saying is, see, these are not conservatives. These are regular people that are turning on the government now. That you've lied to us. People aren't going to listen anymore.
Don't any of you idiots out there with your endless mentality and with your idiocy that's been sucked on by the lying in this ministry that don't know how to take a straight dose of in your life anywhere, anytime in a Christian community, if you haven't got the and the ability to recognize truth when you see it, get your off of my listening frame.
These people do not have the capacity to lock the state down anymore. You can call me Captain Morgan. Continue with the video.
I didn't do a PhD at Stanford University to dribble down to morons the rest of my life. I'm addressing my remarks and have a worldwide network to talk to intelligent people, not morons.
I really love you, for real. That's not the Red Bull ice cream talking. Have a good night, everybody.
And don't make a yourself by tuning in 5 minutes and deciding you're an expert.
So, with that introduction, now I'll get to the main point of this video. Here's the clip of Jonathan's June 23rd Facebook Live broadcast, asking questions he believes are not worth answering. He titled it, How to Turn Your Internet Broadcast into a Million-Dollar Entity with Global Impact, Part 2, 10 Things I've Learned from My First 7 Years Broadcasting. Now this is thing number 8 of those 10, preserved in its 4-minute entirety for full context.
Number 8. Very important. Are you answering questions that no one is asking? Don't answer questions that no one is asking. I saw people broadcast during the COVID lockdown, and you would see the title of their broadcast, and it was like, who cares? You know, in April, it looked like the world was going to end. Nobody wanted to see a broadcast on creative recipes that you can cook for your children during the lockdown. Or you see people just teach, like, today we're going to teach on Genesis. Look, Genesis is a great book. It's God-breathed, inspired. But if you did a broadcast on, like 7 predictions concerning coronavirus from the Bible, where does the church go from here? So, you know, that's what was on people's minds. So you can't ignore what's on people's minds. What do you mean I'm in South Africa, Brandon? They have me on TV? Let me know. Answer questions that people are asking. Don't get in some Christian bubble. Today I'm going to do a broadcast on Calvinism versus Arminianism. No one even knows what those things mean. And people that do know what those things mean have already made up their mind about it and aren't worth talking to. Mm-hmm. Try to have a broadcast that anyone could tune into and be interested. Adalis does a good job at that. There's a famous comedian that's been watching Adalis' broadcast on the Bible. You know? Four steps to overcoming faith. Stuff like that, you know, stuff that's practical. How to be healed of cancer.
Stuff like that. Hey, Fiore. Love you. You're the best. Fiore bailed me out in Camden, New Jersey in 2014. She bailed me out so I didn't have to actually get bailed out.
I thought I was the best.
Great lady.
Hurt my feelings.
Are you answering questions that no one's asking? What broadcast am I doing right now? How to make a multi-million dollar broadcast with global reach? That's what people want that are into broadcasting, so it has an audience. Did God create the world in 6 literal days? Who cares? I mean, the answer is yes, but or the answer is no, from my standpoint, because the sun didn't come into play. Is the Earth only 12,000 years old, or is it millions of years old? Not interested. Did dinosaurs ever inhabit the Earth at the same time as man? Not important to me. As controversial as it is, I don't really, you know, think of it. I'm considered controversial because I deal with stuff people want to know about. How do you make your marriage work? How do you have your kids serve the Lord? How do you make money in the thing God called you to do? How do you stay healthy? How do you balance your marriage and the ministry? I would say you do well hanging out with normal people a little. I don't mean hanging out like you gotta go to a bar. I'm just saying, like, keep some normal people in your life. Don't only hang around like Bible college students or whatever, or ministers. Be around regular people and listen to what they have to say. Yeah, exactly, Alex. Number 9.
First, is it true that no one is asking these questions? No. Pentecostals do an excellent job of preaching about the importance of believing God's revelation to us in the Bible, but a terrible job of showing why it's actually trustworthy. It's a fact that Christianity is declining around the world, and it's a fact that many, if not most, young Christians are unable to defend their beliefs when they leave home and enter secular colleges, universities, or society in general. For decades, Christians have ignored or fallaciously countered the false dichotomy projected by mainstream media of science versus religion. They're actually in the Christian bubble Jonathan mentioned. His advice was, keep some normal people in your life, be around regular people, and listen to what they have to say. Well, that's fine when what they have to say inadvertently harmonizes with what God says about a subject, but what happens when it differs? Or when they ask you why you believe what you do? As a Christian, should you drop the subject and let them continue on the broad road to hell? Or prove that they're wrong and encourage them to repent? Here are 2 examples. The majority of normal/regular people are so far gone that they support abortions if the mother was raped. Why? Because they don't acknowledge God's sovereignty over humans. Why? Because they don't believe Genesis 30:22. Normal regular people support discrimination based on the shade of human skin. Why? Because they don't acknowledge God created the first 2 humans. Why? Because they don't believe Genesis 2:22. If challenged on these subjects, they typically respond in arbitrary, subjective fashion. Oh, that's how I feel, or I'm entitled to my opinion. They have no awareness of an ultimate authority. Sadly, the same is true for many Christians. If they acknowledge Jesus Christ as their personal savior, their intellectual foundation for it is usually sand, not rock. Evangelists are more concerned with the quantity of souls won at altar calls than the quality of that salvation testimony. It's like the difference between wearing a bulletproof vest or an ordinary cloth shirt. Or an even better analogy, it's like giving them a gun and sending them into a violent neighborhood without giving them any bullets. Now, they might never encounter any enemies in that neighborhood, or if they do get assaulted, they might survive by simply pointing their gun at the enemy. However, they might also land in a situation where they need to figuratively pull the trigger and learn too late that the gun can't protect them. God has enabled me to earn my living for over 3 decades as an engineer working daily with normal, regular people. And here's what I've learned about them. Normal, regular people believed the false science-religion dichotomy, hook, line, and sinker. That's one important reason why mainstream media businesses have millions of normal regular subscribers funding their deceptions. Normal regular people dominate the way that leadeth to destruction. Normal regular people shall be likened unto a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. The people Dr. Gene Scott described as uncommon are supposed to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world, in a city that is set on a hill, whose candle giveth light unto all who are in the house. So when those questions arise, and I've seen them in person and in media for decades, did God create the world in 6 literal days? Is the earth only 12,000 years old, or is it millions of years old? Did dinosaurs inhabit the earth at the same time as man? Instead of saying, who cares? Not interested. Not important to me. The Christian response should be, since Christianity, properly understood, is the only sound system of knowledge, which is what the word science means, it's the only basis by which we can know the correct answers and the right way to live our life. Let's examine each of them in detail now, and I'll show you why it's important to understand your beliefs. Here's how to answer question number one. God created the world in 6 literal days because in Exodus 20, the Israelites were commanded to work in 6 days and rest on the 7th to commemorate that event. God could have taken any amount of time to create the world, but chose a literal 7-day week for our sake, as Jesus explained in Mark 2:27. If God had actually created heaven and earth, the sea, and all that's in them over some other period of time, the commandment would be falsely explaining it, but it actually explains it in a cogent manner. Jonathan's remark that God didn't create it in 6 days because the sun didn't come into play is a pathetic example of a Christian losing his credibility. A savvy atheist, or someone near and dear to Jonathan's heart, like Anthony Fauci, could triumphantly reply, "Scientists agree that life evolved over the course of billions of years without any help from your imaginary God, so take your prayers and altar calls and shove them." Question number two. Earth is neither 12,000 nor millions of years old. It's only about 6,000 years old, because the Bible contains a genealogical record of humans that only spans about 4,000 years. And in Matthew 19, our Creator and Savior said, the first two humans were made at the beginning. Jonathan was wrong when he said he's not interested in this, because I know for a fact that he cares about everything the Bible recorded his Creator and Savior saying. Question number three. Dinosaurs inhabited the earth at the same time as man because in Genesis 1, God created land-dwelling animals on the 6th day, the same day as the first humans. Furthermore, humans have recorded encounters with dinosaur-like creatures, and dinosaur fossils have been recovered from sedimentary rocks, which were formed shortly after the global flood. Now, Jonathan said it's not important to him, but it should be when he preaches about the days of Noah resembling modern human culture when Jesus returns, as recorded in Matthew 24 and Luke 17. The visible effects of that flood, including fossils of dead creatures such as dinosaurs, serve as observable, objective testimony to the seriousness of God's judgment. Now, in each of those 3 examples, do you see how easily I'm able to intellectually eviscerate my opponent? There is no argument a non-Christian can give to invalidate information revealed to us in the Bible from God. That's power. And it's more enjoyable than a Red Bull ice cream sugar rush. And it won't even turn your feet black. By contrast, all other belief systems rely on false assumptions that prove to be internally inconsistent upon examination. In philosophical terms, they can be reduced to absurdity. And yes, I'm fully aware of all the interpretations many Christians have used the past couple of centuries to harmonize the Bible with theories taught as fact by secular scientists.
Gap theory, date-age theory, framework hypothesis, theistic evolution, progressive creation. I know about the Bach consecutive, historical narrative versus poetry or prophecy. Sabbath as a noun, Sabbath as a verb. Isaiah 14's description of Lucifer. Jeremiah 4:23's description of earth. Ezekiel 28's description of Eden. And 2 Peter 3:8's statement about a day and 1,000 years.
All of those misinterpretations compromise Christianity because they're attempts to harmonize God's revelation to us with false secular ideas that can't withstand scrutiny, such as the concept that life came from non-life over the course of billions of imaginary years, and that death resulted from natural conditions rather than as a consequence of sin by the first pair of humans. All Pentecostals should care about the reliability and relevance of Genesis, since it explains why humans are sinners in need of a savior. Why preach about Jesus as a savior if there's no such thing as sin? That's an important foundation for the gospel's credibility. Unfortunately, due to their ignorance of the assumptions that scientists use for the foundations of their beliefs, theologians have added those erroneous beliefs into the Bible. Eisegesis. They're like weeds in a garden, and we need to remove them. I'm not going to discuss them here in detail, because I already wrote a 400-page book about it. And it's a worst seller. And there's plenty of online content countering misinterpretations. At the risk of sounding like a broken record, if you care about equipping saints to engage in spiritual warfare and win spiritual battles for God's glory, you need to understand why you believe what you believe, and it needs to be intellectually bulletproof. I'm going to conclude with a poignant statement that one of my former employers, Elon Musk, published just a few days ago. In science, you question everyone, no matter who they are. Facts and reasoning are everything.